is moved just after Ranavendra Singh's talk. So now his talk will be from 4:45 to 5:30. And after which we'll have those panel
discussions. Thanks to the organizers for giving me an opportunity to talk today. So in keeping with the theme of this meeting, I'm going to introduce a new model system here, that of the zebrafish, and how it can be used in studying the development of motor control.
are ideal for studying descending motor control, and zebrafish especially, because
It's a developmental model system. And here you have only about 300 plus spirally projecting neurons. So this is comparable to the total number of neurons that you see in the C. elegans, for instance. And here this is a dedicated network for commanding locomotion, and therefore it has some of the advantages that you could have in a simpler model system such as C. elegans. So you can go back to these same neurons, you can identify the neuron, know what its place in the network is, and what then you can record from these neurons and understand what the function of each of these identifiable neurons is in commanding locomotion. So, because zebrafish are transparent, you can do in vivo imaging and recording in the intact larvae, and most of the projection neurons are in the hindbrain. The corticospinal projections are absent in zebrafish, and these, as I said, can be identified from one fish to another, making your observations statistically that much more powerful. And also the motor pattern is much simpler compared to limb locomotion, because swimming comes about from alternation between the left and the right sides. So the motor pattern itself is much simpler compared to the alternation of reflexors and extensors in mammals, and also the right-left alternation. So you have two different networks talking to each other to produce both flexor-extensor alternation as well as right-left alternation in the limb locomotion. But here you have a reduced circuit that just does right and left alternation, and the command flows through down the cord. So what is zebrafish? Zebrafish are native to India. They are small teleostean fish, and here this is a male and this is a female and a male, and shown here are stages from the zygotic single cell stage all the way to about 3 days. And you can see that the entire early developmental process can be observed through the chorion, and also you can decorionate it, release it from the eggshell membrane, and observe the larva in vivo through all these early developmental stages. So to study motor control in zebrafish means that you have to look at what behaviors can be generated by this organism through these early stages in life. So starting from about one day after the egg is laid, it shows very interesting motor behaviors, including slow coiling movements and touch-evoked swimming. And by about 3 or 4 days post-fertilization, it shows beat and glide swimming, which is a coordination of the pectoral fins coupled with a flipping of the tail from back left to right. So at 3 days post-fertilization, the larva does not show much spontaneous swimming. It emerges only at around 5 days post-fertilization. So when I mean that it does not show much, it shows very infrequent and rare bursts of activity, but for the bulk of time it prefers to stay silent. So here is part of a trajectory, swimming trajectory of a 3-day larva, recorded over 15 minutes, and you can see that the total path traversed by this larva is much shorter compared to what a 5-day larva does during those same 15 minutes. So to understand how the network produces these fundamentally different behaviors at 3 days and 5 days, what we did were extracellular recordings from the spinal cord to look at the population activity of motor neurons. So here are extracellularly recorded action potentials, and also you can record activity using whole cell patch clamp. So I'll discuss data that's been obtained using both of these techniques. So at 3 days post-fertilization, when you record the activity of populations of motor neurons, you find that there are action potentials occurring in birth. And each of these bursts occur with a rhythmicity of about 30 milliseconds. And the bursts themselves are very stochastic in nature. They occur in clusters of episodes. So there is a bound of activity when the motor neurons are in a high activity state, firing lots of action potentials. And then there is several minutes of quiescence followed by another large bout of activity. So when you compare the activity patterns between 3 days and 5 days, you find that there are many, many more episodes of swimming, because these are the command that the motor neuron sends down to the muscle. These are fictive swimming motor patterns, and these fictive swimming motor patterns are much more frequent at 5 days compared to 3 days. So if you just take a cumulative probability distribution of episode periods, within each cluster of episodes, the 3 day and the 5 day episode periods are identical or similar, but what happens is that as the animal matures from 3 to 5 days, these long periods of quiescence get slowly filled in by episodes. Therefore, the very long episode periods, longer than about 10 seconds, are absent in the 5 day larva compared to the 3 day larva. In concomitant with this, what happens is that the episodes also become much shorter in duration at the 5 day stage compared to the 3 day stage, shifting the distribution of episode durations toward shorter episode duration values in the 5 day animal. So these are changes at the level of the episode. There are also changes at the level of single bursts within those episodes. And here, what happens is that at the 3 day stage, the animal produces a single spike or two spike bursts, not more than that. But 5 day animals are capable of producing multi-spike bursts that are wider in nature. So, what are the causes of changes in circuit activity between the 3 day and the 5 day animal? These could be changes in intrinsic conductances of spinal neurons. Maybe the spinal motor neurons become much more excitable at 5 days compared to 3 days, and also they could be receiving stronger synaptic inputs, and also this could reflect how the descending motor pathways control the spinal circuits for producing activity. So these three possibilities are not mutually exclusive, and in fact it's quite likely that what we see is a combination of all of the changes that have been listed here. So what I have followed is the effect of dopamine on descending motor control pathways in the zebrafish. And the reason for that is that dopamine is an early neuromodulator in the zebrafish. Dopaminergic neurons, labeled here with an antibody to tyrosine hydroxylase, are present as early as 1 day post-fertilization. And you can see by 1 day post-fertilization that the neurons are present, and already their axons are making their way down into the spinal cord. In fact, what I'm going to argue for is not a direct action of dopamine onto the spinal cord, but an indirect action, which is dopamine acting on other circuits in the descending motor control pathway, which then influence the spinal cord circuitry. And so there are plenty of dopaminergic neurons starting. So you start to see them at 1 day post-fertilization, and the circuitry is very rich when you look at it by the time it's 5 day post-fertilization. There are dopaminergic neurons in the olfactory bulb, in the ventral diencephalon, there is a large group of dopaminergic neurons, and there are many, many dopaminergic fibers in the hindbrain, which is where the reticulospinal pathway is that I talked about before. The 300 plus spinally projecting neurons are present in the hindbrain, and they are in a position to receive dopaminergic input from these tyrosine hydroxylase positive fibers. And in fact, if you look at single optical sections, so here is neurons in the nucleus of the medial longitudinal fascicle, and these neurons, so the red is back labeling from the spinal cord, so you inject dye into the spinal cord, which travels up into the cell body, labeling them, the cell body as well as the dendrites. And the green is tyrosine hydroxylase immunoreactivity. And in these single optical sections of less than a micron, you can already see puncture of tyrosine hydroxylase closely opposed to the neuronal cell bodies and the dendrites, suggesting that perhaps there is direct tyrosine hydroxylase innervation of the dopaminergic innervation of these neurons. So what does dopamine do to the motor pattern? So interestingly, this is a 3-day post-fertilization larva, recording of spontaneous swimming activity, episodes of them. So each one is an episode of swimming, fitness swimming. When you back apply dopamine, all of this spontaneous activity is abolished, but you can still evoke an episode by either touching or electrical stimulation of the skin or by shining light on the larva. All of the three manipulations result in a production of evoked swimming episodes. And this effect is completely reversible. So, not just exogenously applied dopamine, but also when you back apply a dopamine reuptake blocker, again, you see that spontaneous episodes are abolished in the 3-day larva, and the opposite is seen when you back apply a D2 receptor antagonist. So, sulfuride is a D2 receptor antagonist. When you back apply this antagonist, then the episode frequency increases compared to control, arguing that when you block dopamine, the rate of fictive swimming activity increases. When you enhance the level of dopamine, the rate of fictive swimming goes down. Okay? And D2 receptors are known to act by inhibiting the synthesis of cyclic AMP. So then the question is, can you directly interfere with D2 receptor signaling and then ask whether indeed dopamine is acting via these D2 receptors? So when dopamine is co-applied with forskulin, forskulin activates adenylate cyclase, which results in increased level of cyclic AMP. So it antagonizes dopamine signaling via D2 receptors. So when you do that, even in the presence of a high dose of dopamine, the episode frequency is much, much higher than what you see in control. So this is similar or much, this is the same direction as what would happen if you antagonize D2 receptor action, but much stronger than applying dopaminergic D2 receptor antagonists. Entirely consistent with our hypothesis that dopamine acting via D2 receptors inhibits cyclic AMP synthesis and thus somehow leads to downstream inhibition of swimming, fictive swimming episodes. So, another way you could test this hypothesis is by ablating the dopaminergic circuitry. So here what we did was treat the larvae with MPTP. MPTP is a neurotoxin that preferentially targets the dopaminergic circuitry. And when applied at low doses, it inhibits tyrosine hydroxylase signaling and it inhibits the production of dopamine because tyrosine hydroxylase is critical for dopamine synthesis. So, MPTP treated larvae, when you stain again with tyrosine hydroxylase antibodies, you don't see many of the fibers that you see in control larvae. The neuronal numbers, we treated with a low enough dose of MPTP that we maintained the number of TH positive cell bodies. So the number of TH positive cell bodies corresponds to the number of dopaminergic and noradrenergic neurons. And many of these nuclei have been shown previously to consist of mainly dopaminergic neurons. So the number of neuronal somata is maintained, but the fibers in much of the brain are reduced. The fibers in the commissures are reduced. The fibers in the mesencephalon are reduced, and more importantly, the fibers in the hindbrain are almost absent. So what is the physiological effect of treating with MPTP? When you treat with MPTP, again, because you're reducing dopaminergic signaling, you're increasing the occurrence of fictive swimming episodes. So shown here is the summary of many experiments showing that the median episode frequency in MPTP treated larvae is much higher than in control larvae. And this is an expansion of one of these episodes to show that the episode, the burst frequency, the burst of spikes within an episode, so each line here corresponds to an episode now, within an episode, the burst frequency is similar to what you see in a control RV at about 30 milliseconds or so, which is what we saw earlier. So the episode structure itself seems to be maintained, but the frequency with which episodes are initiated seems to have been increased by MPT D2. So all of that argues that dopamine inhibits the initiation of spontaneous swimming episodes. Dopamine probably acts via D2 receptors, inhibiting cyclic AMP synthesis, and somehow leads to the suppression of spontaneous swim episodes, and that when you ablate the dopaminergic circuitry, you reveal a high level of fictive swimming activity in a 3-day larva where it was low before. Okay, so how does dopamine do this? So we only know that it acts via these receptors, but where are these receptors present? Where is the target of dopamine? So to answer that question, we first started at the most downstream point, which are the motor neurons. So we asked, are these effects of dopamine mediated by a direct action of dopamine on motor neurons? So to do that, we performed whole cell patch clamp recordings and asked, when you back apply dopamine to motor neurons, do you suppress their ability to generate spikes? Do you suppress their excitability? Surprisingly, so first, when we back applied dopamine to motor neurons, so motor neurons have these periodic depolarizations that you can see in current clamp mode. So these are recordings in current clamp mode and here in voltage clamp mode. So in current clamp mode, you see these periodic depolarizations consisting of action potentials and many synaptic inputs. And these periodic depolarizations are brought about by synaptic input coming into the motor neurons. And these synaptic inputs are mixed synaptic inputs. They consist of both GABAergic as well as glutamatergic inputs. And at this stage in life, GABAergic inputs are not inhibitory but depolarizing, because the chloride reversal potential is much higher in young immature neurons compared to older mature neurons. So when you look at what happens in dopamine, the periodic depolarizations are entirely absent, and therefore the spikes that are triggered by periodic depolarizations taking the neuron above threshold are also absent when dopamine is present. So does this mean that somehow the motor neurons are much more leaky in the presence of dopamine and they are not able to trigger action potentials? So to test that, we injected current pulses in control and in the presence of dopamine in the same motor neuron. So this is the same motor neuron, and when you inject current pulses, their ability to fire action potentials is not perturbed by the presence of dopamine. So their input-output characteristic is maintained even when dopamine is present. And many of their passive membrane properties are also not affected when dopamine is present. So these data indicate that the action of dopamine in suppressing spontaneous swimming is perhaps not through a direct action on the motor neurons. So then we had to look a step higher and ask if dopamine is acting on the premotor circuit within the spinal cord. How do you test that? Because the premotor circuit is a very ill-defined circuit. Many members of the circuit are still not known. So as a very preliminary assay, what we did was we isolated the spinal cord from the brain and asked if dopamine can induce, can suppress fictive swimming even when the brain was not present. But the problem was that when you isolate the spinal cord from the brain, you lose all spontaneous activity. Therefore, we induced spontaneous activity with NMDA, which induces oscillations in spinal neurons. So in the presence of the glutamate agonist NMDA, glutamate receptor agonist NMDA, we find rhythmic episodes of activity, okay? And when you put dopamine onto this isolated spinal cord, then you don't see any inhibition of the activity that's caused by NMDA. So this suggests perhaps that dopamine suppresses fictive swimming, not by acting on the spinal cord, but perhaps by acting on supraspinal surface. So to test that idea, we applied dopamine locally, either only to the brain or only to the tail, by this local perfusion mechanism, having two micropipettes, one pressure ejecting dopamine and the other sucking it away, so that there's limited diffusion to other parts of the body. And when you do that, when dopamine is applied locally to the spinal cord, you don't see suppression of these swimming episodes. But when dopamine is applied locally to the brain, then you see a recapitulation of what you saw when dopamine was applied to the entire animal. Seems like application of dopamine to brain was sufficient to suppress these spontaneous swimming episodes. So this argues that dopamine, the locus of dopaminergic silencing, perhaps is supraspinal. So all that is fine, but what happens at 5 days? So I told you earlier that at 3 days, the fictive swimming episodes are not as frequent as they are at 5 days post-fertilization, but the dopaminergic neurons are still present at 5 days and into adulthood. So if dopamine is inhibitory at 3 days, what does dopamine do at 5 days when the neurons are still present and the dopaminergic circuitry is still present? So if you look at swimming behavior in a 5-day larva and you apply dopamine exogenously, you find that exogenously applied dopamine is inhibitory to the spontaneous swimming. So again, this is the trajectory of a 5-day larva in 15 minutes of video recording, and you see that it's robustly swimming around. And when you introduce dopamine at 10 micromolar, then the path length is severely reduced in those 15 minutes, showing that the larva swims much less when dopamine is around. So looking at it electrophysiologically, this is the extracellular recording of fictive swimming episodes in a 5-day larva, and you back apply dopamine, the episode frequency dramatically decreases, which is reversible when you wash out the dopamine again. But what's interesting is that now the characteristics of those episodes that are present in the presence of dopamine are very similar to what you see in a 3-day larva. So the episode durations are increased in the presence of dopamine, just like the long episode durations that you see in a 3-day larva. And also these introductions of these long silent periods between the episodes, about 10 seconds, is present in the presence of dopamine in the 5-day larva, and this is very similar to what you see in the 3-day larva. So it is as if the presence of dopamine can regress the network back to an earlier developmental time. But surprisingly, when you back apply the 200 micromolar bupropion, which is the reuptake blocker, you don't see that the episodes are inhibited. So when you enhance systemic levels of dopamine by application of the dopamine reuptake blocker, there's no effect on the episode frequency. And the same holds for the D2 receptor antagonist. When you back apply the D2 receptor antagonist, then there is no effect on the episode frequency. So these two data points argue that although the receptors are present and the dopaminergic signaling is intact, the levels of endogenously released dopamine are unable to suppress spontaneous swimming at 5 days, but they are able to suppress the spontaneous swimming at 3 days. How could that be? So currently what we're doing is analyzing what relieves the dopaminergic suppression. One hypothesis that we have is that the presence of the development, late maturation of other excitatory inputs, pathways, might compensate for dopaminergic suppression. So where there was only dopaminergic suppression before, at the 3-day stage, perhaps as the animal matures, there are additional excitatory pathways that come in and relieve the dopaminergic suppression. And we're looking at it using calcium imaging of these reticulospinal neurons to understand how dopamine affects the activity of these descending motor control pathways. Now, I'll switch gears a little bit and talk about more recent work involving gap junctions. So, zebrafish are also ideal for looking at individual components of a neural circuit and how those components may be put together to produce functional output. One very interesting behavior that has been used by neuroethologists and physiologists alike is the C-start escape network. So here is a zebrafish larva imaged at about 1000 frames per second, and the grid is actually 2 millimeters by 2 millimeters, so you can imagine how small it is. And a little tap on the side of the zebrafish's head induces it to escape away from the touch stimulus, making this large amplitude C bend. So it looks like a C, that's why it's called a C bend, away from the stimulus and swims away. And this entire behavior, from the start to there happens within about 100 milliseconds, and the latency in fact is very, very fast. So from the start of the touch stimulus to the first movement takes only about 3 to 5 milliseconds. So it's that fast. And a main component that helps in such a fast response is the electrical synapse. So networks have both chemical and electrical synapses, whereas chemical synapses involve a delay because of the release of neurotransmitter from the presynaptic neuron binding to receptors on the postsynaptic and then subsequent channel gating or signaling. The electrical synapses are cytoplasmic continuities. So any electrical signal travels via these pores on the membrane connecting two cells via these gap junctions instantaneously, so the delay is not present. And this helps in many critical behaviors such as the fast escape response that we just saw. So to say more about the gap junctions are assembled by protein assemblies called connexins, 6 connexin molecules, so connexins in vertebrates and inexins in invertebrates. 6 connexin subunits come together to form a heavy channel with a pore in the middle of the 6 protein subunits, and the 2 heavy channels sort of talk to each other and make one continuous pore between one cell and another cell. And where does this lead us to in the zebrafish? So this escape behavior that I talked to you about is actually mediated by a neuron in the hindbrain called the mouthful neuron, which is beautifully labeled in this picture. Here. So this largish neuron here, paired neuron with a contralateral projection, as you can see, so you're looking at it dorsoventrally, has this fat axon for fast conduction all through the spinal cord. And so the mouthful neuron, this is the mouthful neuron, it projects contralaterally to all the motor neurons and some interneurons onto the contralateral side of the spinal cord. And there are gap junctions in many places on this escape network. And the escape network is not just the mouthful neuron, there are other members, but to keep things simple, I'm not going to be talking about these other members. So what we know is that the contralateral mouthful neuron sends an excitatory projection to the motor neuron, and the motor neuron sends a signal to the muscle. So when a signal arrives at the, on the contralateral side, this mouthful neuron fires an action potential, and its fast axon conducts this action potential very fast to the motor neuron on the contralateral side, and all the muscles on this side thus contract, producing a bend away from the touch stimulus. Okay? So where are the gap junctions? So one important gap junction is between auditory afferents present on the otic vesicle to the mouthful neuron. These are mixed synapses. So there are the 8th cranial nerve projects to hair cells. These are bipolar neurons. So one process projects to the hair cells in the optic vesicle, and the other process projects to the mouthful neuron, making mixed synapses consisting of both gap junctions as well as glutamatergic connections, excitatory synapses. And the interesting fact is that we still don't know what the individual contributions of the gap junction and the glutamatergic synapse are. And the zebrafish offers us an opportunity to find out why have a mixed synapse instead of having a pure gap junction synapse. So what we've started to do is look at this protein called connexin. There are several different isoforms of connexin, and we're looking at one particular isoform, the connexin 35, which is the fish orthologue of the mammalian connexin 36, prevalent in brain and retina. And the presence of connexin 35 in mixed synaptic goldfish has been reported. So it's known that it's present in the goldfish, and we are assuming that perhaps it's conserved in the zebrafish as well. But we don't know. So the first data that we obtained is, of course, looking at distribution of connexin 35 in the zebrafish larva. And surprisingly, we find that it's in the, this picture didn't turn. So dark. Can I do something with it?
In the upper layers of the cerebellum, some dorsal side,
And these are the mouth cell bodies, the cells that I was talking about that are involved in the escape response. And these cells show intense connexin 35 immunoreactivity. And also they are homologs. So the mouth cells, the hindbrain is present as repeating segments. The mouth nerve neurons are present in the rhombomeric segment 4, and it has homologous neurons in two other segments, and these also show connexin 35 staining to a lesser degree. So this is just a close-up of the mouth nerve neuron from a different fish, again showing intense connexin 35 puncta in the mouth nerve neuron. So I'll end by saying that this is just baby steps that we've taken towards understanding connexin 35 or how gap junctions are involved in the circuit assembly, and we've used connexin 35 as a tool for this. Currently what we're doing is knocking down connexin 35 using antisense, morpholino antisense oligonucleotides, and asking what happens to the escape network as well as the escape behavior when connexin 35 is knocked down. End by thanking my group. Two of them are here as participants in the workshop. So thanks very much to funding and also to all the members of the group. Thank you. So that has not been done yet. And the other question is about the comparative effects in other systems. So in zebrafish, there are three different kinds of D2 receptors and one kind of D1 receptor, and also other interesting variants of the dopamine receptor, D4 receptor, for instance. And there's one study from another group looking at the effect of dopamine in the isolated spinal cord itself. So the NMDA experiments that I showed, these friends of mine from the University of Minnesota have looked at the effect of dopamine on these isolated tails and find that the episode duration can be controlled by dopaminergic influence on the spinal cord alone. But the episode initiation is still controlled by the descending motor pathway.
Motor neurons also express dopamine receptors, and they also receive directly.
Right. So there's plenty. Yeah. The question is that motor neurons themselves may receive dopaminergic innervation. They may express dopamine receptors, and yeah, in zebrafish, definitely there are tyrosine hydroxylase positive fibers in the spinal cord, and they run in close apposition to the motor neurons. So it's quite likely that the motor neurons receive direct dopamine innervation. And as I told you, this recently, the paper was published about 2 months ago, showing that dopamine has an effect on the episode duration by acting directly on spinal neurons. Still.
Thanks for very nice talk. A few questions. First, is it true also in the adult that there is only 300 descending neurons in zebrafish?
Ah, good question. We don't know. The thing with zebrafish is that most people assume that the circuitry is mature for functional purposes at 5 days, because the animal is a free forager. It does swimming in 3D, and therefore it's assumed that what you see at 5 to 7 days is adult-like, but I don't think anybody has carefully measured the number of projections in the adult.
Second, that if you compare the A3 and the A5 fish, in the properties of the motor neurons, do you see changes in the properties of the motor neurons with regard to after conversation or the IPL things?
Right. So for instance, the passive membrane properties go in the direction that you would usually expect, you know, decreasing resistance and resting membrane potential becoming more hyperpolarized and all that. And you also see a greater frequency of glutamatergic minis showing that there's more excitatory inputs into the motor neuron. But beyond that, one has to carefully look at what other things are changing.
In a tempo, when you go from a single spike to stage 36 to stage 40, whatever it is, you go from single spike to burst spike, and then you have also change on the membrane properties.
Change a rheostat. So it's quite. I don't have a doubt that zebrafish is similar in those respects to tadpole, because we see that many of the aspects of the circuitry are conserved between tadpoles and zebrafish. I'm not aware of anybody that has compared between 3-day and 5-day, neither have I looked at different kinds of synaptic inputs or firing behavior, channels, and densities, and so on. But
do you see any potential implications for the brainstem dopamine innervation on Parkinson's disease and possible like gait disorders and Parkinson's disease?
Right. So I get asked this question quite a lot, because in mammals the influence of dopamine seems to be opposite. So for example, in the isolated mouse spinal cord, when you back apply dopamine, it actually induces oscillations. So the answer I give them usually is that I don't think of systems conserving the neurotransmitter, but I think systems conserve the mechanism. So they may pick and choose different neurotransmitters, but may conserve the mechanism by which a certain network function is achieved. So maybe in mammals it's a different neurotransmitter that suppresses. For example, it's known that in humans, infants, when they can still not balance their posture, you hold them in the air, they can do left-right alternation. And maybe their spinal pattern generation mechanisms are suppressed when their postural mechanisms are not yet ready. And maybe that job is done by a different neurotransmitter. So I would think that the takeaway lesson from this kind of work would be more about the existence of developmental breaks rather than the precise mechanism by which dopamine acts.
If there are no more questions, let's thank Vatsala.
So, just a quick announcement. The lunch arrangements are at different places for different people.